From Carolla One Studios and Teresa's house and Bryan's house, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, security specialist and combatives instructor Ed Calderon. With Bald Bryan on sound effects and Teresa Strasser filling in on news. And now, while other businesses are offering contactless delivery, as a comedian, he's just offering tactless delivery. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice. We've got a mandate. Get it on. Welcome to the show. And welcome, Teresa Strasser, filling in for Gina Grad. Good day.
Adam, it's a great day because not only is it your B-Day, which you do not like to celebrate, but it is also your A-Day, which you do like to celebrate. That is, it's your achievement day. In my inbox today, because I have an Adam Carolla news alert, was news of you making history, 1.1 million video streams of one of your live shows out of Houston with your beloved John Hyatt, Graham Parker, and of course, former Navy SEAL and Congressman Dan Crenshaw. So happy achievement day to you.
Well, thank you. I'll take them both. Yeah. And Bald Bryan.
How about you leave the joking to Adam?
I was sitting around thinking about my achievement day today, which you're not supposed to do on your birthday, but as I've instructed everyone to do, have an achievement day and think about that. And by the way, up your achievement day can move around. Your birthday can never move around. So you guys probably had an achievement day from 0 to 25, but the date of your achievement day may have moved.
It's true.
After 25, and hopefully it should, and hopefully it's going to move around a lot over the course of your lifetime. So think about that date and think about what that achievement date would be. And I don't know, Bryan and Teresa, if you have given any thought to your achievement day. I mean, Bryan, there's obviously a lot going on with your health, and how about a health update from you, Bryan? We haven't had one in a while.
Let's postpone that for a week because I'm getting an MRI on Monday and a meeting with Dr. Rudnick on Wednesday, so I'll have a full picture at that point. So let's table that for a second. But it's funny because the first thing that came to my mind was like, wait, beat cancer, such and such. But that, I don't feel like I achieved that. I feel like it's a great day in my life, of course, but I don't feel like I achieved that. I was very fortunate and it happened to me. I would say maybe the reunion show, which I put together, or the day my book hit the bestseller list would probably, those are the first two that come to mind for things I actually did and put effort into and, saw the fruits thereof.
Teresa, what about you?
Well, I like to celebrate my achievement day on the day I won my first Emmy.
Jesus.
But then
I'm surprised it's not welded to your head.
I seriously considered putting it in the background of this Zoom to remind you guys that I'm not a complete dunce. Also, I'm with Bryan with the health thing. Like, obviously, the day I bore my children, it was their birthday, but it felt like my achievement day, particularly with one, because one was just a C-section. That's an achievement of the doctor. But one, I pushed him out. And I feel like, why are we fetting him on October 6th when I really did the heavy lifting?
That's true.
To be fair, my mom pushed me out as well, but I was 14 at the time. But I do feel like I was pushed out. Hey, Cousin Sal is on the blower, everybody. Hey, Cousin Sal.
Oh.
He's warming up his microphone over there. Can we hear you, Sal? I think you're still
What's
muted.
What's happening?
Hey, man, how are you?
Happy birthday. You're the birthday boy here. What's going on?
We were just, and Jimmy's on now. Right. I was just sort of thinking about the first time. I was thinking about that time we went to that pizza place or the Chinese food place in Manhattan and had that cheap Chinese dinner when Jimmy and I were trying to coax you into leaving your girlfriend and leaving New York and coming to LA in front of your girlfriend. Can we talk about that? Because that was like the first time I really met Sal. Well, I met him a couple days earlier, I think. Do you guys have recollections of that story?
I do.
Oh,
I'm used to making everyone around me uncomfortable. And then you guys really just turned it around on me before we even got the fortune cookies. Yeah, that was something else.
What? My recollection of it was a Chinese food place somewhere in Manhattan. Cheap.
I think that's right.
Yeah, all the Chinese food places in Manhattan are pretty cheap. But hey, can you hear you guys hear me? Or
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I hear you.
Oh, yeah.
My headphones are, I don't hear anything. And I guess I do hear anything. I guess the fact that you guys said yes and I heard it means I can hear you. So that's amazing. Adam, I thought this was going to be a surprise.
It was, but then Mike said, I said, why are we starting at 4 p.m? Because we usually start at 1, and then he just said, ah, screw it. So
yeah, because we popped up and you were just remarkably unexcited and surprised to see us.
Well,
something was wrong.
It's not that remarkable.
I have, you know, the bloom's off the rose. I've spent enough time with you guys, but I was thinking about that, sitting in that Chinese food joint with Sal, explaining that he needed to come back to LA with you, basically, Jimmy, and me, and it was in front of your then serious girlfriend who wanted no part of it.
As I recall, you and I, Adam, were making probably $80,000 a year combined, and we spoke as if we'd found gold in California. We needed Sal to come help pan it for us.
Where else can you make this kind of money?
And you know, we never really—I don't know why—it never occurred to me that his girlfriend, whose name was Melissa, which is his wife's name as well, might not be excited about the idea. I figured, oh well, of course she'd want to move out to California too. Why not? And she was not excited at all about it, and she really didn't like me at all from pretty much that moment on.
And she was also not excited when we had karaoke on her, I think, one and only visit to California. And she whipped out a New York, New York. And Jimmy just pounded right afterwards with I Love L.A. Much, much louder and much more intense version, which brought her to tears.
She set me off when she pointed at you and said, we're leaving today. I was listen. You guys may have explored each other's bodies in college, but I've known you. I've known this guy since he was born.
Thank you.
I just remember sitting at that table thinking, I'm not related to him, and I just met her, and yet I feel like there's a lot of collateral damage coming my way. Like I remember how much she voiced her opinion at that actual Chinese food place. Like, I was expecting her to play it a little closer to the vest. Then once you guys got back to the apartment and the door was closed, that's when she would open up about her true feelings about you moving out to California. Right. She did not. She spoke openly about it at the table, as I recall. No.
Yeah, MSG really set her off. And that's, you know, that's one of the reasons I had to get rid of her. Yeah.
Well, and by get rid of her, Sal just decided to move and didn't tell her he was moving. And in fact, I believe it was our mutual cousin Sally who said to his girlfriend 8 days before he was set to leave the coast, who said, like, are you sad that Sal is leaving? And she said, what?
And that was it. And then when she approached me and said, why didn't you tell me? She was like freaking out. And I said, well, this is why. Look at you. Look how you're behaving right now. So she didn't get it.
Well, that was before they had invented the term ghosting and you disappeared.
That's right. Exactly. Right. Way ahead of my time.
Jimmy, is there any timeline? By the way, I'm enjoying the show you're doing from your living room. And I do think there's some interesting stuff here. I don't mean like lemons, but like I sent you a note that when you did that whole Pence thing and you really put together that monologue, I said, that's probably something you couldn't do in front of an audience. So do you feel like there's things like you're growing artistically and going places you kind of couldn't go if you're in front of that live studio audience with the warm up and the applause and the whole nine yards?
Yeah, it's different for sure. And there are definitely, it's not all drawbacks not being in front of an audience. And I'm trying to maximize the things that are good about it, the intimacy of it, being able to just kind of speak as opposed to perform. But, and I'm trying to write the things that are good down so I remember them when we do eventually go back into the studio. and don't just forget them. But that's always the way, right? I mean, you learn, even like my friends who are in the restaurant business, they, you know, this is obviously a disaster on a lot of levels, but they're also like, oh, I just figured out this new menu item that's very popular. And that, you know, yes, we can send our food out for takeout and it will be fine. And so you do always learn things when you didn't think you were going to, when you're trying to make the best of a situation, I think. And I think that's probably the case for us.
Is there a timeline? Is there any kind of timeline about going back to the studio?
Well, you know, there would be more of, I think there would be more pressure and more of a timeline if we weren't doing the show at all. But since we are doing the show every night, it's not, you know, it's not a gap in ABC's lineup. And in fact, we're one of the few shows that is still on and producing new shows. So I think we'll play it pretty safe and go back when the coast is said to be clear.
Lock it in, Sal. What's the updates for Lock It In on Fox Sports?
Well, we're maybe supposed to go back at the end of the month, but we're waiting on these sports. It seems they're very good at releasing schedules, but not good at making deals with their players. So it's like, yeah, I could say our fantasy football draft is August 20th, and that's great. But these players, some of these deals, these unions are being offered are laughable. And there's a ways to go now, I think, between there. So, but hopefully beginning of July.
I wonder what you guys think about that, because I heard the NHL, they're going to just go right to the playoffs.
Yeah.
I'm all for that. I wonder if people will then look at the regular seasons and go, well, we don't need quite as much of this.
Well, it's funny. I was thinking that Adam must love it because his big thing is baseball's too long. It goes so many games. They're looking at an 80-game season and plus playoffs, Adam. You have to enjoy that.
You know who figured this out a long time ago? Pornography. Because we used to have a whole theme and the pool man was there and she'd serve him some iced tea and he'd wipe his brow and they'd exchange glances. You turn on You Porn now, they're halfway into it right from Jump Street. And the porn industry really has been showing us the way, which is all these games, it's all foreplay. Let's get to the money shot. That's the playoffs.
It's all playoffs. Yeah.
And that's kind of how we are kind of like from a metronome standpoint now, right? Like
we're right in the postseason.
Right.
That's right.
And I'm kind of half kidding, but I'm not really kidding. Porn figured that one out.
I heard that these baseball games are going to start in the seventh inning.
That would be awesome.
Start stretching.
Right.
Dennis Eckersley throws out the first pitch.
Charles Barkley sings, "Take me out to the ball game." Oh, I wanted to ask you guys about this since we're talking about sports. And I watched The Last Dance. I guess you guys, we all enjoyed that, right? With Jordan.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Lance Armstrong, I just saw the first one. Now, I know everyone thinks Lance is kind of a douchebag, but Jay, he shared a lot of the same qualities Jordan had, right? Just wanted to win really badly and didn't really care what people thought of him.
Yeah, but he cheated. I mean, and Jordan didn't do that.
Right. But you watch the story. So how do you reconcile this? So you watch the story and the story is he's number one. He's the number one cyclist in the world in 1996. And then the next year, he's kind of the middle of the pack. And then he realizes that all these guys are cheating. They're all juicing. They're all taking this substance and they're all going to the front of the race. So now, what can he do if he doesn't juice? Then he's a perpetual middle of the packer. And then it creates a sort of, you know, a conundrum, which is if you don't do this thing that's wrong, then no one's going to know your name. So what do you do if you can't get the other people to stop doing what they're doing?
Well, I think you have to speak out and get the other people to stop doing what they're doing. And I think those guys were reluctant to point fingers at each other because they were all guilty in some way. And you know, also Lance Armstrong lied so many times. Like, why would we even believe this version of the story that he did it as a reaction to someone else? I mean, we don't know that to be true. You know, I mean, at this point, the guy has lied. like, it's interesting to go back and watch tapes of him lying in such a convincing way. It's I like watching that because I like to see what it looks like. And when you go back in retrospect and go, oh, this guy's not telling the truth. Mm-hmm. Like, I wanted to believe it because I was like, fuck those Frenchies and America wins the Tour de France. But, you know, then you look back and you're like, they were all right.
Yeah, I feel like Mark McGwire and Sammy Sosa only lied once. Maybe they were only approached once, but you're right. Like Lance Armstrong, he was given like 5 or 6 opportunities. I remember, are you sure? We used to do those sports editorials, Jimmy. And I think like every fourth day, it would be about Lance Armstrong lying.
Yeah, right.
He was one of a kind for sure.
And that's why God took one of his testicles from him.
I'm still going to watch the shit out of that series. And I don't know if it's just any port in a storm and ESPN's got nothing cooking, but I went right from The Last Dance right to Lance Armstrong. And I think I'm just going to keep going. I think we have a picture. Maxipat has a picture of us all in a booth, I guess with Kevin and Bean back in the day in Manhattan. I think, there's Jimmy, there's Sal wearing his Jerky Boys shirt. There's me.
Adults?
Kevin and Bean. Oh, maybe it is Daltz. Maybe we're in LA. Yeah, you're right. And
did Daltz have windows?
No. Maybe, yeah. No. I think no. It may have been the Talleyrand or something.
Yeah.
And Sal just grabbed this waitress and pulled her into the picture. She's not excited about being in the picture.
That's not my ex-girlfriend in a Chinese restaurant?
I'm sure her name was also Melissa.
It was, yeah.
Probably. One of a series of Melissas. Yeah, we were young then.
That's something.
Jimmy, you don't know when you're going to go back, but it's not really pressing because you are back, essentially, from your home. Sal, we'll figure out when the hell sports. I feel like the UFC may have got it right. Maybe the UFC, I mean, those were pretty exciting fights. You think you're going to miss the crowd more than you do? I don't know if I missed them that much.
Not for USC. It doesn't seem to matter for UFC. For pro wrestling, I know you're going to laugh, but it's kind of the same thing. Vince McMahon, Dana White don't have to deal with unions, but it's definitely a difference with pro wrestling. UFC, the backdrop's kind of dark anyway. And the one problem is the trainers now are and the announcers are figuring into the result. It seems weird, but did you see that whole thing where some of the fighters are listening to the advice given by Joe Rogan and others and adjusting accordingly? So they'll admit as much in the post-game interview. But
I can't wait for the NBA games without a crowd. I was actually interviewed Steph Curry about this, and I said, do you think we'll be able to hear what the players are saying to each other? And if we can hear that stuff, I don't want to hear the crowd. I would much rather hear what these guys are saying to each other than people cheering. I can't wait for that.
You know, it'd be funny if they told the guys that were calling the fights, Joe Rogan and others, if they told them, look, they're listening to too much of your advice, so you're going to have to mix it up a little. And they start hearing stuff like, he's got to stop dropping his right and blaming his parents. And see the guy's face change a little, like, hey, maybe I'm living in the past. You know what I mean? Like, mix it up. Get some emotional stuff in there.
Self-help stuff.
That's great.
Adam, since it's your birthday, I want to ask you a couple of questions.
Please.
What do you remember as being the best birthday of your life?
Ooh.
Well, it's going to sound a little self-serving because you're on the show, but the surprise party you guys threw me when we went to Vegas one year, and we went to Vegas, and I think we drove home on a Sunday, maybe it was a Saturday, I can't recall, but we drove to my house, and I'd never had a surprise party in my life. I've never really had any big birthday parties. When I was a kid, we could only afford half a pinata. So it was just the front legs and all the candy would fall out before we even hung it from the tree. We were that poor. And
It was a peen.
We didn't do the yada. We just didn't have that kind of cash, you know? So I think Jimmy was me and you. I can't remember if Sal was there. I can't remember who else was there, but we drove. There was a third person there, and maybe it was some random kind of guy like Elliot or one of your Vegas friends or something. Yeah. There was somebody. We drove to my house and opened the door, and everybody was in there, and it was truly like a surprise party. I'd not experienced that before. And because we were coming home from Vegas, there was never an inkling like where you go like, oh, you know, I'm going to take you out to Color Me Mine and make a bunch of phone calls while you're on the potter's wheel. Like, I didn't get suspicious. You know what I mean? I was just coming home from Vegas, and it was like 7 at night. And we're like, all right, now we're home from Vegas. And that worked. Yeah.
That's good.
What I have to say isn't as uplifting as Jimmy's question, but I wrote down a bunch of names of people who died at age 56.
Right. I'm looking forward to that.
Okay, you want to hear it?
I do. And if you don't, if you want to get depressed, watch The Love Boat, because you'll go, I'm older now than Captain Steubing was in 1981 when he was running that vessel. Like, I'm physically older than he was. All those people you thought were old, you're now older than
you. Adam, you are older than Ray Charles was in the We Are the World video.
That's insanity.
Yeah, I know. That's when it really comes home.
Right. All right, here's a few. Abraham Lincoln, pretty good. This is who you have to beat. Steve Jobs, Beethoven, Rick James, Warren Zevon, John Hancock, which is funny because you could barely sign your name, and Adolf Hitler.
Really?
56 years old. So there you go.
Some real notables in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You could do this.
That is uplifting. And
yeah, there you go.
and last question. So yeah, that's actually a good question. I'll say that surprise party. Sal, you must have been at that surprise party.
I don't know if I was
in LA yet.
Trying to think. You had a couple good ones at the party house on the Blue Top. I'm trying to think.
Well, how about your 30th when Roddy Rowdy showed up?
That was beautiful. That was like a kid's party right in your backyard. What I heard him coming around the corner. He had the kilt and everything, right? You guys flew from Oregon, and he stayed for like 7 minutes and then left. And I was so glad he left. I was so uncomfortable.
That's how I feel too. Whenever there's somebody that I'm very excited about, especially somebody as a kid, I was thinking about recently is Adrian Barbeau, I think we surprised Adam with Adrian Barbeau on Valentine's Day one year on the show.
On your show,
Adam?
Yeah. Oh yeah. On your show.
Yeah.
No, you know that it's a weird thing, and I'd be interested to get both of your takes on this feeling. So Rowdy Roddy, I remember stretch limo pulled up. He gets out of the stretch limo. Jimmy had ordered, it wasn't Chick-fil-A, it was like Cluck a Chicken or something from Phoenix to be
from Vegas. Farm Basket
to be brought. Same great taste without all the religious baggage, basically, is what it says on the sign. So he brought that in. And so Rowdy Roddy came in, and he was all in full gear and everything. But that feeling Sal was describing, which is like, this is great, but also it's uncomfortable. I don't want to fuck this up. And it's that same feeling. If you guys remember when you were young and you'd ask a girl out on a date or to the prom or to some event, you'd go up, you'd ask her. If she said yes, you couldn't get out of there fast enough, right? Like, if I just hang out, she's going to change her mind. We've got it.
You're like Billy Bean in Moneyball. You got the yes, and you hung the phone up immediately.
Yeah. Right. We're going to the prom. See you later. You just like turn around and leave. I'm going to go boutonniere shopping.
I did that one time in sixth grade. A girl named Lynn Engelstad, the only girl I ever asked to a dance, and she said yes, and I was just thrilled beyond belief. And then I got the hell out of there. And when it came time to go to the dance, I dodged her the whole time.
Now, did she know you as the great Jimmy Kimmel back then or Joe Briefcase?
The Briefcase Joe, not Joe. Yeah, it was, by the way, this was pre-Briefcase Joe. Sixth grade was like the peak for me as socially, really. And only because I got one girl to say yes to going to the dance.
How did you?
I never danced.
How did you earn the title Briefcase Joe?
Briefcase Joe was my first day of junior high school. Seventh grade, before I went to school that morning, my mom said, hey, you know, Dad got a new briefcase and, you know, maybe you want to use his old briefcase. And he had this vinyl fake leather briefcase that I wish I still had. And I thought, oh yeah, that, you know, when you get something of your dad's, like your dad gives you his old wallet or something like that, you know, Adam, you probably haven't experienced that, but sometimes dads have things and then they pass them on to their children. So I get this briefcase.
Well, and bad genes in my dad's particular case, the ultimate gift, but go ahead.
You got half a pinata.
I put all my stuff in this briefcase and I go to school. And of course I'm nervous. It's my first day of junior high school, and I'm already a year younger than everyone else in the seventh grade. And I walk into the cafeteria holding my briefcase, and some big kid yells, hey, Briefcase Joe. And a chill just went over my body. And my first thought was, I was just mad at my mother for not anticipating that this would happen to me and for sending me to school with the worst fucking thing you could possibly send anybody to school with, a briefcase. I imagine being called Briefcase Joe for the entirety of my life after that. Luckily, that was the end of it, but I was so embarrassed. I almost threw it in the garbage before I went home.
Well, regardless, if you try
to... Joe Exotic has a similar story.
Yeah. However you may try to poison me on Joan, your mom, it shall never take, because I am in love with that woman.
I know you guys.
We love each other.
Yes. It's weird. My parents have the same like kind of infatuation with you than they have with me, but you didn't have the first like 25 years of life with them. You didn't have that time to, where, you know, it makes you uncomfortable when your mother like kind of stares at you and just goes, says, oh, my son, you can actually enjoy it. Whereas, you know, it curdles my blood.
Yeah, no, I feel the same way about it's like when the guy's a gangbanger and he's shivving people and he's causing trouble and then he goes to jail for 26 years and then he comes out. He's everyone's cool uncle at that point, you know, and I feel the same way about your parents. I missed all the briefcase baggage, pardon the pun, of the early part of the years. And now I'm just left with the lovable Joan and Jim. And they have sort of worked as sort of a surrogate for my family as well, because I do feel like your mom is sort of the mom I never had and your dad's kind of the dad I never had. So
and in a way, I have to say also your parents have been like to me the way they were to you, and that they pay literally no attention to me whatsoever.
Well, to be fair to them, you crossed the line and became successful. And,
and you only have yourself to blame.
Yes. And my mom sort of did, you know, famously with you, what she did with Jon Stewart all those years ago when she announced he was very funny. And then I announced he was a friend of mine. And then she announced he was hit and miss. And then we never spoke of him again. You, my friend, hosted the Oscars not once, but two times just to rub it in her face. And they used to enjoy the Oscars. And
nice. Well, if there's anything else they like, let me know and I'll get involved with it so I can leave them with nothing.
That's a good point. All right. I'll give you guys a plug, not that you need it. Jimmy Kimmel Live weeknights, of course, 11:35 ABC. And you can subscribe to the YouTube channels where, well, Jimmy Kimmel Live, and Twitter and Instagram at Jimmy Kimmel. And then, of course, Cousin Sal, Lock It In, will be back when they're good and goddamn ready. His Twitter and Instagram at the Cousin Sal as well. And I can't wait for this whole thing to be in the podcast. Sorry. Against All Odds with Cousin Sal. Enjoy that every Thursday on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. I can't wait for this whole thing to get over and then all of us to grab a beer and watch some damn football. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
All right, Adam. Happy birthday, man.
Appreciate
it. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Love you.
Hey, guys.
Bye. Love you too. Yep. Take care.
All right. That was sweet. Let's see.
Wow. I'm touched, Adam, by that heartfelt love you.
What a surprise.
Yeah, sort of.
Because you've been emotionally distant way before being socially distant, but that was really authentic and heartfelt.
Yeah. You'd be, Teresa, I was sort of thinking at the beginning of this whole thing when they were talking about staying 6 foot apart. And Fauci would give those, he'd go, you got to stay 6 foot, no touching, no handshaking, put a mask on. I kept praying he would go, and no eye contact.
Can do.
I mean, Adam, remember that time I started being your news girl and you didn't look me in the eye for 6 months?
I was listening to Fauci.
6 months, he fast-tracked you.
Do you also remember a time, it was hilarious, but I think it was partially serious, when I announced I was pregnant live on the air and you asked your assistant Jay to hug me for you.
You outsourced your hugs.
You outsourced it.
I was on the vanguard of this whole social distancing. Yeah, I look at me good. Don't look at me as cold-hearted. Look at me as a pioneer.
I do.
All right, let's see. Well, good. We have some news. Oh, we have I have a little clip from my audiobook to play as well, which is coming out on the 16th. But you guys can pre-order it, and that would be a nice birthday present for me if you pre-ordered my book, because they tell me it's important. They tell me that if you pre-order it, it just helps get you into more outlets and so on and so forth. Dawson, you have I'm Your Emotional Support Animal. What segment is it? This is
This is from it's chapter 3. I forget the name of the chapter, but this is the nice little bit you put together on why Lynette loves those Dateline shows.
Here we go. Dateline and all those Friday night true crime shows. These are heroin to Lynette. Whether it's about a mother killing her kids, like with the whole Casey Anthony trial, which Lynette didn't miss a second of, or making a murderer. The Netflix documentary about the random photographer for the Auto Trader who got murdered when she showed up to take pictures. Lynette's all in. My wife could be an FBI profiler based on the amount of true crime she studied. She definitely watches Dateline because their fear-mongering tagline is, don't watch alone. And she definitely tries not to watch alone. Now, she tries to get me in on it. My thought is, yeah, there's some really horrible people out there. I'm depressed enough with my life. I don't need to peek into someone else's tragedy. These shows are loved by all women and their cuckolded husbands. They're catnip for the pussy whipped. I don't know and wouldn't want to know a guy who's into this shit. Henry Rollins is not watching Dateline. It's just not practical enough. These murders are solved. It's not like if you can crack the case halfway through, you can call in and win a prize. Chicks don't understand statistics. They watch this shit and think, well, there's a 50-50 chance that'll be me. It plays into the victim mentality. Something could happen to you or your family. It's always inter-family. It's never a Crip shot of blood. The end. When a ferry overturns in the Indian Ocean, we don't even notice it because we're not going to be on any Bengali boats anytime soon. But we're all going to let our kids walk to the park. It has to tickle that could be me part of women. It has to pull the fear lever for them. In a quiet neighborhood. Wait, I'm in a quiet neighborhood. It could happen anywhere. Oh shit, we just bought a house anywhere. We're days away from a promo that says, on a special 48 hours, look behind you. And that's coming out on the 16th. So pre-order that bad boy now. I'm going to hit True Nijin and we'll take a break. We'll do some news with our favorite Teresa Strasser. First, True Nijin. You've heard about the trend of NAD boosters. There's only one backed by both clinical research and regulatory approvals as well. True Nijin, from age 40 to 60, humans experience a near 50% decline in NAD. Leaving the mitochondria, there we go, to compete for a shrinking supply of their most valuable energetic resource. So I take this stuff. I was talking to Shannon Sharp the other week. He takes this stuff. A lot of athletes and celebrities take this True Nijin quietly. So you can, you got a lot of stress on your immune system, lack of exercise. Overeating can also deplete NAD because cells have to expand and use more energy to function. Support cellular defense and repair with True Niagen. Visit TRUNIAGEN.com. Use the code Adam. Get 20% off any 3 month plus supply now. But it's closing out fast, May 31st. So get going on this now with True Niagen. All right, let's take a quick break. We'll come right back and do the news with Teresa Strasser right after this.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail.
Hi, I'm a 37-year-old semi-educated white male, and I pre-purchased the Audible version of Emotional Support Animal for two reasons. Number one, working in an aerospace machine shop, being able to hear ACE in one ear and pneumatic tooling in the other helps me to work better. And number two, I think ACE is a better reader than I am. Thanks. Get it on. Woo-woo-woo.
You can leave us a message at 888-634-1744.
Well, you better hope that last statement wasn't true, sir, because that would put you at a real deficit for this thing called life. All right. Ed Calderon, our security, all things Mexico expert, is going to join us a little later on. But first, Teresa Strasser and her news.
From the New York Post, Christian Cooper, the black man who filmed a white woman calling the cops on him in Central Park, said he feels uncomfortable with the amount of backlash that she's received, including losing her job. You've probably all seen the incident on video. Cooper asks the woman, also named Cooper, her name's Amy Cooper, they're obviously not related, to leash her dog in an area.
Why is it so obvious, Teresa?
I'm sorry. He asked her to leash her dog in an area that it was required, but she refused. When he filmed the encounter, the woman, now known as Central Park Karen on social media, calls the police and falsely accuses him of threatening her life. Now, Christian Cooper is asking people to stop threatening the woman who called the cops. Quoting Christian Cooper here now, "It's a little bit of a frenzy and I am uncomfortable with that," he said to the New York Times. "If our goal is to change the underlying factors, I am not sure that this young woman having her life completely torn apart serves that goal." In an appearance on CNN, he said he considers the woman's actions racist, but he urged people who were outraged by it to stay civil.
Well, that's nice. A little voice of reason. I like that. That's refreshing.
The man is obsessed with birds. He's a member of the Audubon Society, and he was just out there trying to watch the birds. In any interview I've seen with him, he does come across very reasonable.
What? Articulate, Teresa?
Articulate.
Clean. Articulate. What else? Did she issued a pretty heartfelt apology as well, right?
Yes. All and right. He mentioned that he did acknowledge receiving her apology.
Well, we can probably turn the page is what I'm saying. There's enough out there for us to be concerned with. Now,
I agree. This woman acted horribly, but her life is being disproportionately ruined, I would say. Like she acted like a real bitch, but like, let's fucking calm down, everyone. She didn't kill anybody.
I agree. And I didn't know, I'm not sure how the bird watching factors in, but I don't know what her dog was up to, but.
Okay. Her dog. Do you know that she had to give her dog back?
Yes. I heard. But I'm also saying nobody's taking her side. But in this particular case, if somebody lets their dog off the leash, unless their dog is doing something to you, you can also sort of look the other way with that as well. I've been to many places where dogs should. I guess at dog parks, a lot of the time, dogs are supposed to be on the leash. But I would never tell anyone to put the dog on the leash. But I don't know what the dog was up to. The dog could have been chasing the birds away or dry humping his leg. But
I think the former. And I think that's why it's germane to the story, because this is a specific area for bird watchers. And the dog was probably scaring away the birds.
I guess. I don't, how does that work? Are they on the ground? Are they in the trees? Like, how does that, I walk my dog all over the place. I literally had a crow attempt to shit on my dog yesterday because it, like, it sat up in the tree and it just started making those crow noises, like, rah, rah, and we were just both looking at it. Rah, and as we got a little closer to it, it dropped a bomb right on us. But either way, all right, this is nothing. She's been punished. He's being gracious about it, which is nice. I like that.
Do you feel that the name Karen is going to go away? Because there aren't any more Adolfs, and I'm not comparing the two, but now
as a result of the cultural phenomenon.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. Well, it was a popular name when I was in high school and then junior high. There's plenty of Karens in my junior high and high school class. I don't know that there are any in my daughter's classes, but
there's no Karens in my kids' classes either. So maybe that's why it's called a Karen, because a Karen is of a certain age.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas a Harper or a Charlotte is going to be younger.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Emma.
Sophia.
Emma. Yeah. Exactly.
Right, let me flip this theory to you guys. This wasn't so much racist. I mean, it's a little bit, but like, she wouldn't have acted any different if it was a white guy. She would have done the same thing. I think the Karenism of our society, as we see it here manifested, is these fucking women, like Adam, like you alluded to yesterday, in a zero gravity environment. She hasn't been told what to do in many years, and now there's someone telling her to leash her dog. She lost her fucking mind. I think it's a lot less racism and a lot more like, how dare you tell me what to do?
Yeah, there used to be a kind of humbling gravity that all kind of kept everyone sort of in their lane. It's sort of like when you were 9 and anybody's parent could tell you anything, including discipline you, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it was just a sort of, you lived under this constant gravity of, just think about the relationship a young person has with law enforcement now versus the relationship you had with a cop when you were 14 or whatever. A cop looked your way. Yes, sir. No, sir. Whatever it is they told you to do, you just do it, you know, or a parent or an authority or a principal at school or whatever it is. And in general, there's just kind of a lifting of the authority. And so if you're on a plane and the flight attendant tells you to, you know, put your tray table up, half the time people go, fuck off. Like, they just lost their relationship with authority. It's mm-hmm. kind of like, I always say, I talked to Drew about this recently, but I've said it a lot. Money became invisible. And when money became invisible, we kind of lost our relationship with it. It's sort of like, keep California shut down till the end of the year, print up some money and drop it off. You know what I mean? Like, make some new money. Right. Like, it's a kind of we're all guilty of it with credit cards and online banking. Yes.
Why do you think Vegas uses chips?
Right.
You don't think about the money you're throwing out. If you're throwing out $20 bills, you'd feel a lot different than if you were putting out little discs.
So we've kind of lost our relationship with money, and we've kind of lost our relationship with authority as well. And if you go to my house, you'll realize nobody who lives in it has any relationship with authority or money. So I just come walking in. I'm not the authority or the person who makes the money. I'm just some dude who lives in the house who's trying to tell them shit to do that they don't want to do.
Well, there is an industry where cash is very much still in play, and that is prostitution.
Mm.
You may have been wondering how sex workers have fared during the coronavirus. Jimmy Kimmel.
I was just thinking about that. Yeah.
Jimmy Kimmel earlier mentioned that restaurant workers are struggling. Of course, the hospitality industry is struggling. Well, sex workers are also struggling. This from the New York Post. Enterprising Swiss sex workers have devised some inventive ways for their colleagues to service clients without spreading the coronavirus by using certain positions that they feel are safer, and those are doggy style and reverse cowgirl. Sex workers drafted new guidelines in the hopes that Switzerland will lift the temporary ban on prostitution enacted 2 months ago over COVID-19 concerned both of the aforementioned sexual positions, that's reverse cowgirl and doggy style, allow for a safer distance between faces, according to sex worker advocacy group ProKRay in Switzerland. I hope I'm pronouncing that right, where prostitution, by the way, is legal. They claim these prostitutions can reduce the likelihood of contracting or transmitting the virus via water droplets that are inherent in missionary-style intercourse. Now, I should say there is no evidence that these positions can mitigate the risk of contracting COVID-19, which can travel as far as 13 feet.
Well, feels scientifically dubious.
It's a windfall, obviously, for the guys. First off, we need... Now more than ever, we got to bring back the glory hole. And the glory hole,
this time has come.
Which was normally plywood, 3/4 inch plywood, now needs to be replaced with 1/8 inch thick plexi or Lexan. Thus, first thing, there's a benefit here. Everybody's going to pick up 5/8 of an inch on their dick because as you formerly, like when my granddad... And his father before him would use the glory hole. That was 1 inch thick. You know, that's a piece of hefty material there. Obviously, you're going to burn the first inch of your dick just getting it through the hole. Plexi and Lexan, that runs about 1/8 thick. So just getting rid of the 3/4 ply, replacing it with the 1/4 inch or 1/8 inch Lexan is going to buy you 5/8 of an inch of much needed dick length. Okay, people? Genius. That's number one. Number two, it's right in the sneeze guard. I mean, a sneeze guard is literally made out of that material. Also, one of my problems with the former glory holes, it was so impersonal. No eye contact. I had no idea what color the gal's hair was.
I think that was the allure. Where it was the anonymity.
Perhaps for some. but not for this savvy buyer. I wanted to see what side she parted her hair on. And now with the Lexan, not only do I pick up 5/8 of an inch of, again, sorely needed length. Obviously, there's nothing we can do about the girth. Sorely needed length, but also the kind gaze of the worker on the other side of the glass. And
speaking of gaze, perhaps you want to go for a frosted plexiglass just to keep the allure. You know, it could be anyone over there.
You're right. Good call.
So you're basically proposing a genital sneeze guard.
I'm saying, look, and obviously we can't all go to the whorehouse. At some point, the mountain's going to have to come to Muhammad. And that's why what I do is I have the shield that the riot police use.
Right.
Savvy.
Obviously, we take the insignia off it because emotionally that can slow things down for the gal sometimes. And we just, I just travel with that. I set it down.
She's swat in her face.
Now, Adam, I have a practical question. Could you repurpose the acrylic in like the stripper shoes?
Once we get enough mileage out of them, we will melt them down and make them into acrylic stripper shoes. But for now, this is the safest way I know to visit a sex worker.
It's sort of a version of the Recyclarola.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
If you will, right? Because it's a hole.
Much smaller.
The hole's a lot smaller.
I've seen the one in your home, and it's just a hole in your wall.
Right.
You throw the recyclables through.
Is it? But it's that if all I was recycling was Mentos, it would be perfect. But not bottles and cans. But yes, I get your point.
Okay. Speaking of comparing length, you're going to think that I'm making this up or that this is a wives' tale. But there is a study showing that men with longer ring fingers may have a lower chance of dying from the coronavirus and could be more likely to face mild symptoms. This is according to a new study published in the journal Early Human Development. The reason, the length of ring fingers is believed to be linked to how much testosterone men are exposed to in utero. So the longer the finger, the greater the hormonal exposure, and testosterone is believed to protect against severe coronavirus-related illness. So you'd be just as likely to contract the illness, but you wouldn't get as sick if you had been exposed to more testosterone in utero, which you can tell if you have a... So do you guys have a long ring finger?
You hear that? You see that, ladies and sick people? Longer than the index finger.
Oh, yeah. I don't... wow. Let's see. My index and my ring appear to be the same. There's the middle, the ring, the middle, and the index, right?
Yep,
I think my index and my ring, they seem to be the same length. Or the ring finger's a millimeter shorter. About the same length. This is how I would describe it.
Teresa, now, is this turning you on?
Bryan, remember that if your hand is bigger than your face, you are in fact retarded. So go ahead.
Okay. I'll be sure to take that test later.
Well, no, you got to kind of just like right. The audience kind of wants.
Oh, damn it. Oh, son of a bitch.
So, but it's interesting that men are dying at a higher rate than women. So how is that testosterone benefiting us?
You are asking the same question that scientists are also asking.
Is it because older men have lower testosterone? It's obviously killing older men, older people, you know what I'm saying, at a higher rate?
I don't know.
Just a guess.
This is a question for scientists everywhere who really know very little about this. One day it lives on a surface, one day it doesn't. One day it travels 6 feet, then it travels 13 feet. So I think every day we learn a little bit more and every clue gets us closer. So this will be interesting. The testosterone has to do with receptors in the lungs. It's pretty complicated, but hopefully they'll get some clues from this that'll help them get more and more information to help treat people who do get it and do get severe symptoms. Now, do you guys, are you open to hearing some Christian rock?
Yes.
Okay. I think they're going to fire up a song for me. Oh, there goes.
Already all sounds right. That like it sounds like an Imagine Dragons song or whatever. Go ahead.
Okay. So we turn that down a little bit. Thank you. Okay. So you are hearing Jonathan Steingard. He's the lead singer for Hawk Nelson, which is a Christian rock band.
Mm-hmm.
All right. You can turn that off. You get the idea. Mm-hmm. Thank
sounds
you.
Like most like a lot of pop rock these days. Yeah.
Well, he had a really successful career in this Christian rock band, and then something happened. He decided that he no longer believed in God.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a come to Jesus, a literal come to Jesus, and he had to renounce his faith last Wednesday in a lengthy Instagram post. He said he had been terrified to post this for a while, but it felt like the right time for him to be honest. He grew up in a Christian home. He was a pastor's kid, playing and singing in a Christian band and having the word Christian in front of most of the things in his life. He wrote, "I am now finding that I no longer believe in God."
I'm going to talk to my son when I get home, and I'm going to explain to him, you should make it your entire life without ever renouncing anything or writing open letters. I will die happen.
It's never.
Never. I can make my entire life, I will not renounce anything, and I'm no open letters.
But people are frequently renouncing things in open letters.
Oh, I will do a lot of denouncing, and I will write a lot of closed letters. Yes.
Hold on, Adam. You've renounced the Zanku chicken that wouldn't give you a combo plate, and you renounced the insurance agent who wouldn't come out to do your cars. You've done a lot of renouncing.
I renounced the Zanku chicken in Van Nuys, but then I drove to the the Hollywood Zanku chicken and got my 50-50 shawarma plate. So it was a regional renunciation, but it was not a global renunciation. And I'll explain the nuanced differences to my children as part of my renunciation speech.
in your open in an open letter to your children.
That's right.
Oh, toward the end,
Is there anything blowhardier than the open letter to your kids or just writing the letter to your kids?
I don't care for that at all. There's a lot of that and I don't care for it. It's always an open letter to my daughter and it's about not having body shame.
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah,
can't
I don't
you
like
just
it.
Tell her? I don't like that.
She's right up the hall. She's one of the few people you can actually, she's one of the few people you can speak to in person without putting shoes on.
Publishing this open letter is way more effort than talking to her.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Toward the end of his Instagram open letter, he said, "I'm open to the idea that God is there. I'd prefer it if he was. I suspect if he is there, he is very different than what I thought." And I want to say that following his post, the singer received an outpouring of support from other Christian artists, including 10th Avenue North singer Mike Donahue, who wrote, "Man, I love that you shared this. You know, I'm always around to talk about our belief in God or lack thereof. Love you and always will." So maybe he just needs to be introduced to the concept of the great magnet.
Well, I know there's like devil kind of worship rock and there's Christian rock. Is there agnostic rock? Would that be like U2? Would that be like Boz Scaggs? Like, is there a middle ground?
Oasis was pretty agnostic in the day, if I recall correctly. They would count.
Okay, because I feel like it's feast or famine. It's either Christian or, you know, Ozzy Osbourne's biting the head off a bat. You know, for me, I like a little agnostic rock. That should be a Sirius XM channel.
The Beatles, after they're bigger than Jesus?
Right.
I think you need to write an open letter demanding agnostic rock.
That's a good point. All right, let's do one more.
Okay. Alaska has now unbanned some books after outrage from the community. The school board there fell under national and international spotlight after saying in so many words, "F. Scott Fitzgerald." We don't want the Great Gatsby. They didn't want the Great Gatsby. They didn't want Catch 22. And they felt no need for any of the children to find out why the caged bird sings. The books were deemed controversial because of concepts including sexual references, rape, racial slurs, and seeds of violence and profanity. In a board meeting earlier this month, dozens testified against the decision. And during the board's latest meeting, at least 80 cars showed up outside the district's building to protest. Nearly 600 tuned into the meeting's live stream, and the book ban was overturned.
You know, it's a weird time we're living in, but when I was growing up, if somebody wanted to ban something, it was sort of like, well, they were religious fundamentalists and they didn't like these overtones or the sexuality or the gay overtones or something like that. That still exists. Now we have a whole group of atheists on the left that don't like what Tom Sawyer called his buddy he met on the river. And now there's these two groups, both don't agree on anything, but they do agree on censorship. And that's a little bit scary for all of us in the middle, right?
Yeah, that's absolutely.
Don't you feel? Yeah. I feel like people can read things and hear things and make up their own minds and decisions. I don't think it needs to be censored.
Let me share this with you guys. Sorry to interrupt you, Bryan. I wanted to feel like I was doing something productive during the pandemic. So I read my kids To Kill a Mockingbird one chapter a day. I read it to them aloud. And I don't know if you've read that in a while or ever.
It's been a while for Adam.
Forever for Adam.
Adam's been banning books for decades.
Right.
To Kill a Mockingbird, which won a Pulitzer, is essentially about a rape. And a trial surrounding that rape of a white woman accusing a black man. And there are so many N-words used in this story because it took place, I think, in 1932, and that was the vernacular. But when you are reading it to kids, you sort of do have to trust that they can understand the context of the story.
Well, you know, we all grew up. Look, I watched Roots, you know, the 8-part series when I was a kid. We watched it straight through. There was an utter context for it. You know, we understood what it was. It wasn't like this imagery is not suitable. I understood what it was. I understood what the words they use and how it's unacceptable today. That's part part of the maturation. part of becoming adult is being exposed to those kinds of things and having to kind of wrestle with them a little bit and to sort of work them out in your head. You know what I mean? The idea of avoiding all that is fine if you're going to perpetually be nine. But I mean, if you're going to move into maturity, you're going to have to start being exposed to some of those ideas. And then hopefully you have a group around you, like parents, who can put things into context and explain things. And that's, we kind of understood that in the past. The, you know, wrap everyone in bubble wrap, dip them in Purell and keep them away from those ideas. Fine if they're never going to leave the house, but at some point you're going to have to hear a bunch of ideas and then you're going to have to decide which ones work and which ones don't. And also, I don't think hearing ideas or seeing imagery or hearing words, good or bad, they don't make you think it's okay. You know, I mean, I don't think kids are that malleable. I think you see these images and you hear these words and you go, well, let's not make that mistake again. That's how most people think. So we don't give ourselves enough credit. We really
Bryan, what
don't.
Were you saying before I cut you off so rudely?
I forget. I was saying something along the lines of like, these aren't you know, the Anarchist Cookbook or Mein Kampf. You know what I mean? These are books that these are literary works. Granted, they were controversial at the time. Right? There's some ideas that may need some explaining, but let's not get carried away.
And also, it gives you some context for like where we were and where we are now and how much we've progressed and how, you know, being gay was a big deal and a serious mm-hmm. issue and horrible things were done to people. Now we've evolved to this place where it's not that, even though daddy still thinks it's yucky. most of us have evolved is what I would say to my kids. And by the way, we should take some pride in that evolution. We should go, this is how we used to treat black people. This is how we used to treat gay people. Now we've evolved. And why that wouldn't be a good message, I don't know. All right, Teresa, let's bring it home, baby girl.
Thank you so much for letting me sit in for the great Gina Grad. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that was the news.
Teresa Strasser and the news. Fuck you, CNN.
All right, let me hit Geico here. Everyone is sharing these days, sharing your dance moves and your DIY haircut fails and your inner lip sync star. Now, Geico's going to do a little sharing. They're going to give back 15% credit on car and motorcycle policies for current and new customers because Geico's committed for the long haul. So the 15% credit lasts the full policy term. Visit geico.com/giveback for info and eligibility. That's geico.com/giveback. Okay, I'm going to do a one-on-one with Ed Calderon, the man who knows all things Mexico because he was born there and he's done security there, and he'll tell us all about what the cartels and everyone else is up to. I'm going to bid adieu to Bald Bryan and Teresa Strasser, and we'll take a quick break. We'll be back with Ed Calderon right after this.
I'm your emotional support animal, navigating our all-woke, no-joke culture.
My baseline, my factory default setting, is right. I can be very right or super right, but I'm never wrong.
Written and narrated by Adam Carolla.
So grab a seat, preferably a toilet seat, as reading about how our society is going down the shitter will be good reading for when you're on the shitter.
Pre-order it now at adamcarolla.com.
Ed Calderon back on the show, security specialist, combatives instructor as well. Website, edsmanifesto.com. We like to talk to Ed about all things Mexico and drug cartels and that whole world, which is endlessly fascinating. Good to see you again, Ed.
Good to see you after the whole shutdown thing.
Yeah, I think the last time we were talking, we were kind of talking about Mexico and how it's affecting folks over there. You're born and raised in Tijuana, worked for Tijuana security. Was it a policeman? Would you just say policeman, or what would be?
Yeah, I worked for the Mexican government. I did police work for the Mexican government. You know, that's kind of the title. Back then, there was no federales. It was not that.
What do we have? So it's like here, you could work for the sheriffs, and you could be on the west side, or you could work for the Glendale Police Department, or the Pasadena Police Department, or what have you. Is it? Sort of. Did they break it up that way there?
Yeah. There's three separate police groups out there. You can go to Tijuana and get stopped by the municipal police, and then you get let go and told, yeah, nobody's going to bother you. And then the state police will stop you a little further on down the road, and then you'll let go. And then you go down Rosarito, and the federal police will stop you, and they all will, you know, that's the three separate entities right there. And right now, with the way things are, right, the Army and the Mexican Marines are actually policing Tijuana right now, Mexico right now. They've been given policing powers by the current president. So
why?
Because the corruption, he's found out, again, like all past presidents, that most police units are corrupt at their core.
Is the Army not corrupt at their core?
Yes, it is. There's been many cases of corrupt Army officials. The only one that's kind of been kept relatively clean has been the Marina, or the basically the Mexican Marines. That's who the U.S. has bet on as far as the tip of the spear against the cartels. But like all units that down there, eventually, you know, somebody will you'll guess the price on some of these people. And there have been cases of, you know, Marina units being caught helping the cartels, doing abductions for ransom. So it's a free-for-all.
You know, as I think about it, it's almost impossible. It's like, I'm going to screw this up because I don't know a lot about these days. But, like, let's say back in the day, you lived in a castle. You were the king, and he had a beautiful princess, a beautiful queen, right? And then you were gone a lot, and you didn't want guys fucking her. So you had to hire a bunch of eunuchs to hang out because you could trust them because, I don't know, they couldn't get a boner when they were drawing her bath. And I don't know if that's how they used eunuchs or not. You got to look it up, Max Pat. But what I'm saying is there's an inherent problem, which is, you got this hot young queen, and any guy you bring in, no matter how great his intentions are, eventually he's going to get a boner and try to fuck the queen. And so whoever you bring in, as long as the drug cartels have that much money and you value your life as well, you're going to take the silver over the lead, as we always say, and they always say. So in a way, you almost need an outside entity who's not being paid and doesn't care about money and doesn't want money, who's not corruptible. I don't know how you can do it from within, because you say, well, they bought and paid for the police force, but then bought and paid for the Marines. Yeah, but let the Marines police them for a few years and see if they don't get bought and paid for.
Yeah. So
is that an accurate statement?
Yes. Main thing is that it's a circle. Every 6 years, a new president comes in, thinks he has the best ideas to police Mexico, and he does the same exact thing. New police force, different uniforms, different names, and they eventually, well, they're turning into a corrupt group, and they're getting paid for, so let's put it in the Army. And then the Army goes in. The Army doesn't know how to police a public, public city, like a city. They don't know how to do the paperwork to put somebody in jail. So they have somebody, a high level cartel guy, that gets let free after he killed a bunch of people because they don't know how to do the paperwork. And it's just a circle. It's a circle.
Is there ever? And I don't know if you can answer this question or if you've ever studied this, but has there ever been a society that was very corrupted and worked on graft and payoffs and bribes and everything that undid themselves, you know what I mean, that went back to more of how Western Europe is or how we are in the United States?
I haven't seen anything like that in Latin America. Like the only thing that, you know, people like me from down there that would study and kind of look at was prohibition, the prohibition era United States, how how there were gangsters rolling around with Tommy guns and shooting up banks and moving alcohol through some of the, you know, running alcohol into Chicago. And you kind of get a glimpse of what we are experiencing in Mexico right now when it comes to local police corruption you had back then, complacency with some of the local governments, how some of the police forces work with certain mafia groups, but not other mafia groups. So each mafia group had their own police forces on their bankroll. So in the United States, you had that. How that ended? Well, Prohibition ended. That was probably a factor to that. And since it was a single, basically alcohol, that was a single thing that changed. You know, I'm not saying everything went, everything turned out better afterwards, but, things changed at a fundamental level.
Well, you were saying that the cartels are so diversified now that stopping fentanyl or just drugs, in just the one thing, like alcohol, you couldn't just stop the one thing anymore.
Maybe that could have been the case back in the late 70s, maybe early 80s, as far as stopping it when it was growing. I think, mob era, prohibition era, criminal groups kind of mirrored a lot of the, people watch that narco series on Netflix and see how some of the Mexican cartels kind of came up. That's what they mirrored back then. Now they're diversified. Now they're transnational. Now they have people working with them at all levels, from real estate to chemical to people moving things from China to Mexico to extortion, pirated goods. They have their hands in everything. So it's not such an easy solution than just legalizing drugs, right? It doesn't even make sense for a place like Mexico that. With the COVID epidemic, it shows you that they couldn't handle all of a sudden having to treat now drug addiction down there. They can't handle the COVID epidemic down there. The hospitals are overrun in most of these places.
Yeah, how is that affecting Mexico? Because when we were talking before, it hadn't really taken hold. We're speculating that the folks got a little more sewer rat in their system and a little tougher immune system. What happened?
It is affecting some parts of Mexico, coincidentally. Tijuana is one of the ones that's been getting it the worst because of its connection with California. Mm-hmm. So most of the cases are cross-border cases, people coming in with the virus from the U.S., not the other way around, like some people want to kind of claim. So the hospitals are kind of not fully overrun, but they're on the breaking point with people coming in sick. It's business as usual. It's hard to maintain small rules or shut down orders down there. Like the beaches are full,
Right.
The only weird phenomenon that happened is that a beer was declared non-essential. So there's a drought of beer all over Mexico right now. I actually had to buy some Tecate beer, which is made traditionally an hour away from my hometown in San Diego, because there's no Tecate beer in Tecate, which is pretty mind-blowing.
Why? So have they done these stay-in and shelter-at-home orders and people have ignored it?
They did it for the first 2 weeks, and then they realized that we don't have stimulus checks heading to people down there. There is no social net that's going to help out the people that engage in some of this, alternative commerce down there, basically people that live off the day-to-day by selling their tacos on a taco stand or tortillas. It's just not comparable to the U.S. So people had to go back out, basically, open rebellion to some of these rules, and people had to just go back out and work again.
Does what the current administration in Mexico? What do you think of him?
He's a open leftist. Has openly said he's pro Maduro regime. There's pictures of him. With some. All of your not friends of the U.S. as far as global wise. So he's a leftist, populist president. Right now, his numbers, his approval numbers with his handling of the COVID epidemic are very, very low. His approval numbers as far as his handling of we're going through the most violent time in our history during his presidency.
What is the election cycle and or the rules? I don't know.
Every 6 years, there's no re-elections.
No re-election.
No re-elections.
Six is your max.
Six max, no re-elections. He's working on changing that, by the way, right now, which is kind of worrying.
So it's kind of interesting because it's right in the middle of ours in that we will guarantee a four, but you're not guaranteed eight in a weird way. Guaranteed six is an eight, but it's a sort of compromise that some would take and some wouldn't, I'm assuming. But I keep kind of thinking about the end game. Like, I keep kind of thinking, like, you know, I grew up in SoCal. I used to go to Tijuana a lot. I went on many sort of Rosarita and beyond, like kind of Baja beach trips. For people who haven't been there, Baja is just incredible coastline, and the water's great, and the food's great, and the people are great, and it just seems like such a waste in a way that country. And also, I've worked with so many Hispanic guys because I work in the construction field in SoCal, and that's like all you work with. And I don't want to wax poetic, but I just mean hardworking, humble, kind of basic guys, like regular guys who kind of like the simple things. And I'm attracted to those guys. I don't like the highfalutin guys. And I know everyone does that shit where they go, I don't like all that. I like the quiet, whatever. Yeah, you're walking the fucking red carpet every 10 minutes. But I like these like dudes. And I've found these guys to be consistent and kind of centered and kind of good salt of the earth kind of guys. It's sad that the country's so fucked up. Like it could be this great thing. Like we should be going into Tijuana and going down to Rosarita every five times a year. You should pack up your pickup truck with longboards and mini bikes and go down camping on the beach there.
I get complaints all the time on my social media platforms because I said, Ed, you're from Mexico. Why are you bad mouthing your country? Why are you talking all these negative things about your country? Why not talk about the positives? Well, I was a janitor in my country. I wasn't a tourist advisor. I didn't, I wasn't a beach inspector. I wasn't a hotel inspector. I was a janitor, basically. I took out the garbage down there. So that's what I got to see. And that's what I can share as far as my opinion.
You took out the garbage in terms of the criminal.
Yeah, I worked at a street level, you know, I got my hands dirty. My nose was broken by some of these people. I was shot at by some of these people. That was my experience. There are beautiful places down there. Yeah, I've had this experience once. I was talking to some friends about it. I went to the 28th parallel that divides Baja into Baja Sur and Baja Norte, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lady there, and she was ashamed that all she had to give us to eat was lobster and egg burritos. She was like, that's all I have. I'm sorry. She apologized. She kept apologizing. And, you know, we saw how much they cost. And, you know, it's beautiful, dangerous, weird freedom down in Baja, which there's something to be said about that dangerous freedom. When I say dangerous freedom, I mean you can have a party down there all night. You know, next day, the cops will show up and they'll keep it down. And then you'll pay them off and they'll leave. And, you know, it's cool freedom in a way, but those small rules don't get followed and the big ones don't get followed, and then it's everybody for themselves, which in the end is what, you know, Mexico has turned into. Everybody's for themselves. The whole social structure kind of goes to the wayside when you know, people don't follow those small rules. You know, the big ones don't matter anymore. That's why the army comes by and, you know, the cartel wins, you know, that type of stuff.
Yeah, I remember just sitting in the back of a pickup truck just driving on dirt roads, lighting M80s off a cigarette and just throwing it at the truck behind us just for jokes, drinking a beer. And it always kind of struck me, which is, well, the rules are no real rules, so you get to do this. On the other hand, you guys are going to sleep on the beach tonight and somebody could come up and take your truck. So that's the downside of the no rules part of it. But just going through little villages and trying to think of that place you reminded me when you said lobster breakfast burritos. There's some place right outside of Rosarita. It's like a pier that has
Puerto Nuevo.
Probably just Puerto they Nuevo. Just bring over huge
it's
piles.
Just lobster.
Lobster and big piles of tortillas and butter. Yeah, and you just put it right in the middle of the table.
It's a middle. That's I went to the East Coast recently, and I had lobster, Maine lobster.
Mm-hmm.
That's what is that?
No, it wasn't as good as this stuff.
No, lobster in Mexico gets deep fried in pig lard.
Yeah.
And you get the flour tortillas and the handmade beans and the rice and a beer, and you're sitting on the beach eating it. And for some reason, I think that's way better.
There's something amazing about this, as I recall, was a long kind of pier that went out and big tables, and everyone would kind of share
it. That's at Puerto Nuevo. It's you know, right now, you know, changes as far as expenses go. It's pretty safe. But you can go down there and have a lobster dinner for about $50.
Yeah, it was great, and surfing on the beach and everything else. But so I keep thinking, like, when are we going to turn this tide, or do we get to the point where, like, the cartels become the government?
Well, they are the government in some places. That's the thing. Some places, you know, with this COVID epidemic, there's a bunch of pictures going on online of these cartels actually distributing aid to the people that are affected by the shutdown, with like the El Chapo, one of El Chapo's daughters distributed handout food with El Chapo's picture on it. And the government is nowhere to be seen. Guadalajara's New Generation Cartel distributing things.
We're looking at it.
Some Northwestern cartels distributing their wares, and they actually make these high production videos of them. They seem like a political campaign ad, mm-hmm. where these guys in ski masks and AKs are just handing food to the elderly and stuff like that. So they are winning the hearts and minds side of the war when it comes to the government. Something happens there, they don't call the cops, they call them. And they come out and they'll get the guy that's stealing there, and they'll beat him with a board or worse.
Well, it's going to sound a little rough, but at some point the people are going to have to not tolerate it. And as long as the people tolerate it, like, we talk all the time about how this country is racist, but we're really not. And it's because we won't tolerate it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, they go, there's these Klan members, and the president's like, he's a Klan member. And it's like, we won't tolerate it. It doesn't, it's not to say that it can't happen or doesn't exist. But what I'm saying, like, in general, they're just things we will not embrace. We won't embrace. You're not allowed in this country to marry your daughter. Why? Because we won't tolerate it. And we won't tolerate the Klan in any numbers that mean anything at any time. We won't tolerate a lot of stuff. Somehow, at some point, the citizens of Mexico have to not tolerate this. I don't know that you're going to change it any other way.
Two observations. There is the vestiges of what once was the right to bear arms in Mexico. That's one thing. So that's people look at me sometimes when I talk about Second Amendment, how beautiful it is to have it in some places in the United States, not all. But Mexicans, a group of people roll up to your farm with AK-47s, and you don't have a rock to throw at them, right? You get held up on the roadside, and then the cops come over after you get held up, and it turns out the cops work for the robbers, and they're back for your ATM PIN number so they can go empty out your...
Right.
So that's one side of it. Also, the other side of it is that is the normal for Mexico in some places. They don't remember a time before, so that's the normal.
Right.
Recently, there was this very infamous case of a high-level Sinaloa cartel member that was captured on his way to Amsterdam 7 years ago. The guy had an Instagram account and posted pictures of him with Ferraris driving down Paris, Paris, and he had a video of him and Paris Hilton at a Manny Pacquiao event. This guy's the head of the biggest Sicario group for the Sinaloa cartel back then. And he's living life and posting stuff on Instagram, blurring out his face. Probably not the smartest thing. He got caught in Amsterdam, right? Put in jail, let go a few weeks back by the U.S. government under supervised house arrest.
By the U.S. government?
By the U.S. government.
Let out of jail In Mexico.
In the U.S.
Oh, in the U.S.
He was extradited from Amsterdam.
Extradited from Amsterdam to the U.S.
U.S., held for 7 years. Nobody knows what happened. Probably, he probably turned into a witness. Who knows? He was let out under supervised house arrest, and he escaped, of course. He left his thing behind. He left. He went to Mexico, crossed into Tijuana, probably met up with some of his family members, and he went all the way back to Sinaloa because, you know, the desperate usually go back home.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, they threw a big party for him.
Is it Jose Rodrigo Gamboa?
Yep, the El Chino Anthrax.
Thank you, Max Bannock. Yes, go ahead.
There's a few. Really, that guy should have a movie made out of him. He's a pretty interesting guy. He goes back to Sinaloa. It turns out the Sinaloa cartel is aware of all his information that he's probably provided to people. The rumor is that they found a tracking chip on him, put in by, you know, probably the U.S. government. He got killed with his sister and the sister's husband, and they were left outside of Sinaloa in a car, wrapped in a blanket, after they basically shot all of his house where he was staying at and dragged them out. Now, the reaction of the citizenry when they saw this wasn't that of, good, you know, they got this, you know, one less out there. It was sadness. It was a celebration of this, like, this guy got away with, you know, he got out of the custody of the U.S., you know, he got the best of him. You know, he, you know, made it this far. So, like, it's a he was buried with a celebration. There's going to be corridos made out of him, folk songs. This guy's going to be remembered. We don't have Spider-Man down there. We don't have Captain America down there. We have El Chino Anthrax down there. That's what the kids are going to be. That's the comic book the kids are going to read. You know, that's the hero they're going to emulate. So that's our normal down there in a lot of places, like Sinaloa, like the Tijuana. That's what the youth will see, you know. That's what they're seeing. That's their normal, basically. I don't know how else kind of to explain it.
No, I get you. It's like if you ever taste Vegemite, you'll want to throw up. But if you grow up with Vegemite, you love Vegemite.
Yeah,
that's your normal. To us, it's like it's unpalatable. Yeah. And if you grow up in, you know, Studio City, and you hear about this kind of behavior, like, what the fuck? No, but that's not growing up with it.
Yeah. So we grew up. I was a big dork when I was grew up. So comic books. You know, I read comic books. I watched movies. That was my thing. Now kids in their 15s, 14-year-olds are watching cartel exploits on Instagram, seeing who killed who now and who's in charge of what territory. There's a Mexican bingo loteria game with the cartels, the narco loteria. So they're playing the loteria game, but with the narco guys on there. They're hearing these songs play, glorifying some of the exploits of some of these cartel guys. And that's what they grew up with. And now there is a sort of cultural validation when they see this stuff show up on Netflix. And now now it's a Netflix series. So Now on the U.S. side, Mexican Americans are growing up with that, and it's turning into a normal, culturally normal thing up here as well. So it's pretty interesting.
Well, let's talk. I want to tease this, but I want to. Last time we were here, you were telling me about a lot of these pockets. I don't know, sleeper cells or whatever in the United States. You know that it wasn't about people sneaking over. It was about people here getting established, yeah. And not, you know, instead of smuggling drugs or guns or humans or whatever across the board, they just were here and established. So I want to talk about some of these cartels, and I want to talk about what's new with that and what more we can talk about with that so we can scare the crap out of you guys. First, I'll tell you about Mercari. Have stuff you don't use around the house, cluttering everything. Kids' baseball glove doesn't fit anymore. Dress only worn once. Old phone in a drawer. Mercari, it's a selling app. Makes it fast and easy to sell almost anything. Simply take a few pics, add a description to your items that is listed. Mercari will even email you a shipping label when it sells. No meetups, no hassle. 600,000 plus reviews. 4.8 star rating, by the way. That's about as good as it's going to get. And you don't have to throw the stuff out. I hate waste. I can't stand throwing stuff away. And you can get a little money back instead of throw it away. So don't let that stuff go to waste. Sell it, or you can also buy almost anything on Mercari. Find Mercari on the App Store at Mercari. That is M-E-R-C-A-R-I. Mercari, the selling app. So let's talk about what they're doing in this country, how we're handling it, and are they doing it sort of in plain sight?
So from what I know, and a lot of the work that I did was at the border, so I got to see, you know, the interaction of people on the U.S. side and the Mexican side. So U.S. law enforcement doesn't trust fully or at all some of the law enforcement out there, so they don't share information. And some of the information that happens down there doesn't get shared with the U.S. So, you know, basically they're fighting two different wars in two different places, or the U.S. is basically outsourcing their drug war to Mexico. And they're just like, here's money, you know, do whatever you have to do down there. On the cartel side, they've been conscientiously moving their operations up into the U.S. for years. First through birthright citizenship. So El Chapo has kids that were born in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
That's not uncommon for most of the people that work in some of these groups. It's a status symbol. I have my kid. I'm going to have him in the U.S. He's going to be born an American. I'm going to have a passport. There's like a few famous cartel guys that have actual, you know, American citizenship that worked down in Mexico and would escape back to the safety of the U.S. You know? Mm-hmm. Think about that. It used to be you would escape to Mexico to hide.
Right.
That was the other way around.
There's a whole Christopher Cross song about riding like the wind, I think. I got such a lot to make it to the border of Mexico. But he wasn't coming this way. He was going that way.
Well, right, again, it's like a reverse Uno card that's currently happening. The cartels are growing their operations in the U.S., and they have been for a long while. Legalized pot in Mexico, legalized pot in California, cartels moved up and started growing it illegally in public lands on the U.S. side. And the money that was being made from their illegally grown public land weed would not go back to Mexico. It would stay in the U.S. because they were established in the U.S.
So how would that work? We legalize it.
You legalize weed. So there's a market, open market, legal market for weed. So you can make your illegal weed and kind of, you know, try to go into that market as well.
And undercut and get paid?
So the legal weed is
not regulated.
The legal weed is more expensive to grow. And it's, you know, so the illegal weed is being grown in a field somewhere. The costs to produce it are minimal. So you mix that out and you bring it back down into a place like this, and you could sell it to unsuspecting white people without realizing what they're buying.
So they think they're buying this stuff that's been regulated, so to speak.
Yeah, there's still a market for it, and also some of that weed just goes to places where it's not legal.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So, you know, pot's kind of an interesting subject because we have kind of two entities in this country. We have the sort of hard right guys. They're like, beef up that border and get more guards over there and stop this shit from coming in. And then we have your harder left people, which is, well, just decriminalize everything, and then there's going to be no market for it. But you're kind of saying, and then so what we did with weed in California is we went, okay, decriminalize weed, but the cartels are fluid.
Yeah.
And they're going to keep thinking of ways to, they're not going to snap a pencil and go, fuck it, no more money for us. They're going to morph into some version of legalized weed that gets them paid.
So you legalize weed in California, the hills that were usually covered in weed are now covered in poppy fields, and they switch to heroin laced with fentanyl in a lot of places.
That's in Mexico.
That's in Mexico.
And then out here, they'll just grow the weed.
Yeah, and out here, they'll just grow the weed, or they still cross Mexican weed for, that mean it's still a market in some parts of central United States to illegal Mexican weed still gets crossed into the United States, which is pretty, you know, funny.
So it's this, I always kind of look at it like big business. You know, so California, heavily regulated, heavily taxed. So they go, here's what we're going to do. We're going to regulate, we're going to tax. And then the business, big business, could be Nissan. They moved. Toyota, they moved. You know, Apple goes out to China. You know, I mean, they're headquartered here, but they're doing all the manufacturing there. The film and TV industry goes to New Mexico, goes to Canada. They're fluid. They want to make money.
Yeah.
They're not good or bad. They just want to go make money. And so you think you're going to go, okay, here are the rules. And they go, okay, we heard that. Okay. Now here we're going to go figure out a way to get around that and make money.
Yeah. No, that's...
And big business does it theoretically, legally, and they still do it. The cartels who have no legality at all, they get to do whatever the fuck they want. You're not going to stop them by making these proclamations.
And another thing people have to realize that some of these groups thrive within immigrant communities. And immigrant communities are notorious for not reporting things to the authorities when things happen because they're afraid.
Right. I always get in trouble for this, but I still mean it. I always meant it. I've always said it, which is like, they always do this thing where it's like, oh, it's not the people, it's the government. It's not the people, it's the government. And I go, what part of Sweden is the government from? Like, they are the people that govern the people. There's certain, I grew up in the San Fernando Valley. The San Fernando Valley, when I was in the sixth grade, was pretty just lily white for the most part. And that's what it looked like. I don't mean aesthetically. That's the culture of it was that. At some point, it became 65% Hispanic. And then when you started traveling around, go down Sherman Way, go down to Panorama City, go down to Roscoe or whatever, you start hearing the music, seeing the culture, seeing the lifestyle that I saw when I would go through Tijuana. And the answer would be, well, why would it be any different? Of course, that's what it is. That's the culture. So when the culture comes in, the culture takes over. And you can say that's good or that's bad, but it's accurate. It's what Germans would do. If a bunch of Germans moved in, there'd be a bunch of schnitzel places and sauerkraut places and a bunch of Porsche repair places.
I'm an immigrant. Like, I'm from Mexico. I went through the process legally. And the first thing I did was they asked me when I was doing my process if I could speak English. Like, yeah, I'm speaking English right now. Oh, okay. So they have things set up at the start so you don't assimilate. So most things are set up so you don't assimilate. You go through a process and you go out and move wherever you're going to move in the U.S. And you usually there's no push or effort done by any sort of the powers that be to make people try and assimilate, basically. I don't mean forget where you're from, you know, forget your culture, but like, you know, the first part of my American experience was in California, and I got all of the bad advice from fellow Mexicans that had already made that trip. You know, you can get some government money through here. You don't have to pay for this. This is how you do it over here. This is the hack you do to move over here. And I was like, well, you know, I want to start my business. I want to do this, you know, I'm going to pay taxes for this, pay taxes. No, you're doing it wrong. So you have these groups of people that will give you all the, you know, depending on your side of the equation, right or wrong advice.
Well, the assimilation, it's so insidious to me because I could remember when there would be some ordinance or some bill would come down the pike and they'd say, we should teach English only in schools. These kids got to learn English. And then everyone would be called racist for doing that.
I think the problem with that, it goes twofold. If I come here to the U.S., I want to have success. I want to be able to provide a very beautiful future for my family. I have to let go of some of the stuff that I'm running from in Mexico. Some of the stuff I'm running from in Mexico is people don't obey those small rules. Hey, there's building codes here. I don't care. I'm going to make the roof out of my house out of a tarp. Why? Right. Because that's what I want. I can do that if I want to. I don't want to put my kid to school. You know, I'm going to just leave him home, you know?
Right.
So those types of things are the things you flee And now you come here and like.
That's why everyone thinks I'm a racist dick, but I always go, you left that shit.
Now come here and do things
our way. And it doesn't mean you're abandoning your culture.
Anybody that says that's racist, I'll gladly put him in a car with me and I'll drive down to eastern part of Tijuana and see how people live down there and see why people are desperate to find a better life for themselves and their family. That's not racist. That is an assumption of the reality that people are escaping. I've had people call me out on being, you know, racist or whatever, sellout or, you know,
Tom Bien.
Yeah, cool. I work down there. I live down there. I have family still down there. I still go down there. I still do work trying to help people down there. Anybody that says that it hasn't been down there, actually done work down there, spend a night down there. Spend the night down there where you can't trust the cops. There's no 911. People can roll down into your driveway, peek in, see if you have any cute daughters. They take to a party, and then you will never see them again. People have their sons abducted, and the cops don't know where they are. Nobody knows where they are. There's no help. There's just desperation. There's not even a grave, you know? That's what people flee. Now, they come over here and they want to start a better life. They want to start they want to look for a community where they can belong and do something better with their lives, and do something better or have a future for their families. And I was just in downtown LA a few hours ago, and I'm from the third world. And under those overpasses on that 10, that's beyond third world right now, right? So you see some of those realities up here now.
Yeah.
And you're like, wow, bum wars and fires and these guys are living on the overpass. Like, why doesn't the homeless problems in the U.S. compared to Mexico? Go down to Tijuana and see if you can find an overweight homeless person with a smartphone. I'll dare you. Double dare you.
Well, back to the culture part of it, which is I've been here long enough and I've seen pockets turn into Mexico, and it's the street vendors and it's everything, the businesses, the music, the culture, the whole thing. And now I start thinking to myself, well, the joke's kind of on you because you came over here to start to do something, but you don't speak English. You're living in a pocket,
a bubble,
a pocket of what you left. Now the crime isn't as bad, and the other negatives aren't as bad, but there's still some more of it. And if you learn English, assimilate, spread your horizons out a little with the culture, then you could have all the things that you came here to get in the first place. And the politicians aren't helping because they're saying, how dare you tell those people to do that? Well, that's what's best for those people.
Yeah. I don't know what the solution is. I'll just say what helped me out. When I came up here, I had amazing people around me that helped me through the process, not just my family, but also people that, you know, one of my best friends, and I consider him like a teacher, service member. He's a Navy SEAL reservist, Dan. When I came up here, it's like this is you know, this is how it is, you know, these are the rules. Here's a small copy of the Constitution. You know, that's a pretty good thing to read. You know, this is the history of the country you're in. These are the rights, you know, this is how you should be. And, you know, if you don't turn on politics, politics will turn on you. So all the things that I needed to kind of start in my process of becoming an American, which is something I've never take it for granted. I always want to earn it every day. I just want to earn it somehow. I went into that experience with people guiding me towards where I had to be, and not people, you're here. Awesome. Sit down. Just sign up for the check that's going to get here every few months. These are the benefits you get, and you're fine. Just, you know, chill out. Just ride it. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
It creates a permanent underclass, and it creates it with Mexican people, black people, white people. It creates it with anybody. If you just go sit down, wait for that check, do not worry about going out there and working overtime or weekends or getting it done, then it'll create it. It's not really about your nationality. It's about if you get free shit, your shit will get fucked up. I've seen it. I come from it. I understand it clearly. And the people who get the free shit, ironically, are the most angry people that, because it hobbles you and it ruins your ability to go. All you have, and that's all this country is you have the freedom to go out and make some hay while the sun shines, or you can fuck up and be a failure, but it'll be up to you.
Yeah, for opportunities, you know, again, people that complain about this country, you know, hop on a magic carpet ride. I'll take you down to some of these places so you can see what it's like in other places where there's no hope in some of these environments for any better future. And, you know, again, I get called out for saying things like this, like, hey, Ed, that's pretty good English you speak. Yeah, I work on it. Why? Because I want to learn how to speak English, and I don't just want to half-ass things because that's not how I roll, right? Hey, Ed, you talk about these issues, and why are you talking about these issues? And aren't you afraid that you're talking about too many details about what's happening with the cartels? Yeah, but I feel responsibility that to the people that are still down there to make things better, and I think awareness is going to help that out, right?
Well, let's. I want to talk, take a deep dive into the cartels. We need to take a quick break. Ed Calderon is with us. Edsmanifesto.com is the website. Quick break. Back with Ed. Cartel dive right after this. So, Ed Calderon, the cartels, ever evolving in a way smarter than any politician or sort of government member could be, because they're like, I don't know, alley cats or something that just know all the cracks and crevices. You can never capture them. What can we do? What does the current administration of Mexico think about our current administration and vice versa? And can we ever come together on something? And here's a bizarre question, but what about outside administrations? What, I don't know, Canada, do they weigh in at all? Why is it always sort of U.S.-Mexico? I know we share a border, but I mean, it's always like U.S.-Mexico. Are there any other countries involved?
So the symbiotic relationship between U.S. and Mexico, again, I conclude myself because I pay taxes up here. Ouch. Our taxes pay for the drug war in Mexico. Mm-hmm. Through called El Plan Mérida, the Mérida Accords. Basically, the U.S. has outsourced the drug war to Mexico for the past over almost two decades now, and you know, things like the equipment they use, the training they get, the cars they use, the firearms they get, all that is paid by U.S. tax dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so. It's in their best interest of the companies down there supplying all that to keep it going. That's one thing. So there's a symbiotic relationship with money. Now, in the time that I was down there working, like I got these H&K rifles that were pretty good, you know, German made, you know, came with a sight on them. They're pretty expensive. All these new vehicles, Ford Motor Company, Chevrolet, all these cars that we used to use down there. And it's like, hey, can we get some Nissan, different ones that we, no, Ford Motor Company or Chevrolet, those are the only ones you can get. Why? Oh, there's certain stipulations, that's what you have to get. Oh, okay. So there's a whole economy around that war and a whole symbiotic, and if you shut that money off, well, people are going to, like, why is the money off? Like, what's going on, right? And I've never saw any sort of accountability on the Mexican side to where that money goes and how it's spent. And also, you have been sending down money consistently for the past, again, more than a decade. And things have been getting worse, not better. So right. If I were, you know, an investor investing in a company to make money, and every year it's, you know, they're making less and less money, or it's becoming more and more violent, then I have to question my, you know, investment.
Right.
But it doesn't seem to be the case. Now, as far as the relationship between the current administration in Mexico and the current administration in the U.S., it's a live and let live type situation right now. I mean, there doesn't seem to be any sort of combined effort to go after the cartels that I can see or that anybody can see outside of, you know, a few high-level arrests that are made and a lot of big deals made out of them.
What would happen if Trump said, like, well, we're pulling out of the WHO, or we're pulling out of NATO, or we're pulling out of funding
for
Mexico.
No more money for the cartel.
No more money. You guys are on your own.
I think the reality of the problem would hit Mexico a bit harder. So now you have a despondent police force that's not going to get the funds that they were accustomed to. They're going to get the rundown vehicles, and they're going to start not being able to patrol that much. They're going to have to find their own funds for it. So they're going to be more specific and more interested in how that money gets spent internally. So I think there's going to be more of an effort done for that money to be spent in a smart way and where those resources get allocated, I think.
Do you think that would be a good idea?
I think that would be an amazing idea if somebody actually did that.
Why is it never on the table, or is it on the table?
Because American companies actually live off it as well.
So no senator is going to bring it up. No congressman is going to bring it up.
Every Mexican cop wears the same brand of uniform, and it's a specific tactical brand that sells every single uniform that every cop in Mexico wears because of that international accord. So there's people making money on the U.S. side by the piles, you know. So that there's interest in that as well, right, which rarely gets talked about, but it's also the case.
So there's too much money on our side for anybody.
There's a lot of people making money off it.
And our government to say, we're going to put an end to this.
There's a lot of people making money off it.
And it's kind of weird. I don't think the American people think about it that much.
They should. They should question where their money goes to. Like, I question it. And I got the first time I paid taxes, like, well, now I can complain about it, right?
Right.
I used to be on the receiving end of some of that money. So I remember one time we had firearms issued to all of us, and they were German. So people out there that are gun nuts, H&K G36s, polymer space rifles from... They looked like they were from space. Like, I saw them, like, it's a space rifle. So they got all these expensive rifles. So somebody made a lot of money with that arms purchase, with that firearms purchase, not in Mexico. And we got all those rifles. And immediately after that, somebody else put a contract in, and they wanted to change those to another brand.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like they were trying to take, you're enjoying these too much. Give me, these are the new ones. Use these ones now. So somebody was making boatloads of money just off the firearms we were using.
Right.
So again, there's a symbiotic relationship, not just Mexico puts drugs into the U.S. and feeds a population of people that are addicted to it, but also the Mexican government is addicted to the money that gets put into the problem by the U.S. for it to be utilized in things like national security, policing Mexico, and working against these cartels. And consistently each year it gets worse and the problem gets bigger. So something is wrong with this.
And the cartels are just expanding and their reach is broadening. And we've talked about them kind of wanting to fly under the radar a little bit. It doesn't behoove them to make a lot of noise or do a lot of, like, when they shot up that Suburban with the,
the Mormon family in Sonora.
Yeah, that they were Mormons, I guess.
But again, you know, I can't, the fact that they're Mormons was said a lot in the media. They were Americans.
Right.
They were.
We don't really look at Mormons as Americans.
I don't know.
Utah.
So yeah. Kids, babies, women, American babies, kids, and women were killed in the desert in Sonora by the cartels, and nothing realistically happened after
that. Well, you know, it's an interesting thought, which is our media is fucked up, and our media is right now, if you called it the Wuhan virus, they would be more angry at you than they would for China for releasing the virus and devastating the economy and health of the world. So their priorities are fucked up. So when they're sort of anti-religion, which is, I'm not sure where that comes from. They're not big fans of religion, and they see Utah as this kind of weird white person. They don't like white people. And they don't like religion. So strike one and strike two if you're in Utah. So And they also have this theme, which is white people oppress brown people. That's the theme. So if a black cop shoots a white teenager, that's not news. Obviously, if a white cop shoots a black teenager, that's a huge story. That's how they roll. And if people don't believe me, you can't think of all the examples. I work with Mark Garagos. He represents a lot of those white kids who get gunned down by cops of any color. And you don't know the story because you've never seen the story because CNN doesn't report the story because that's not part of their theme. So here you have religious people, white people, extra white people from Utah who are over there and they were killed by brown people, which doesn't really fit a theme. And people are listening and going, well, CNN reported it and whatever reported it. It's like, yes, they did. They didn't turn it into Ferguson.
So the perspective that I had from that, so I knew people of that, the LeBaron family, that I knew them back from the time where they were basically, they have these communities in Chihuahua and Sonora where they, long story, I'm not a religious expert. People can do whatever they want. They believe whatever they want. They had these communities there. They wanted to live very Mormon, their Mormon lives there. Some Mormons say they weren't Mormon. They're not their type of Mormon. I don't know. The thing is that these guys lived in communities, and their communities were paradises in the middle of these cartel, you know, distraught places, right? The first time they came to my attention was that they set up a legitimate defense against some of these cartels that start to harass their communities. Cut forward years later, kept in contact with some of them, you know, one of them emailed me the news of that happening. This hadn't made national news yet. Nobody was talking about it, really. So I posted it on my Instagram account. A group of Americans were just killed in the desert. They're part of the Mormon community. That's, to me, that was secondary. You know, they're part of this Mormon community that lives in Mexico, but they're Americans. And this happened. It's horrible. Like, you know, people should focus on this. These people are Americans. They're women, they're children that were killed in the desert by a cartel group. You know, there's some sort of reaction has to happen. And as soon as you start seeing in the news cycle, weird Mormon stuff to happen in their family. Right. I don't know what they were doing down there. So they're probably up to something shady, you know, what they were doing in Mexico. They're probably in the drug trade. So you start seeing all these things. So like, hey, forget the fact that they're Americans.
Right.
They're Mormon. They were doing something shady down there. Why were they there?
Right.
You know, they were saying that they were doing something shady there. These were two women, babies and babies and vehicles that made a horribly wrong turn and wrong decision to go down this road. They were on their way to this wedding. And they, case of horrible mistaken identity, that's what I managed to, you know, come up with as far as an explanation after seeing all the details around it. And the way you saw it on the media, weird Mexican Mormon cult killed in the desert.
Yeah, I know. We completely glossed over the American part. We kept doing the Mormon part. And again, there's a theme, and the theme is whitey kills black people and whitey kills brown people. And if that's not really part of it, if you flip the script on that, they'll give it a little bit of ink, but it's not really in their theme. And it's sad. It's weirdly not the way anyone should go about reporting the news.
In Mexico, you can have somebody get shot 100 times in the middle of the street. Everybody sees it. And it doesn't show up on the news. And that's normal.
Really?
Yeah. There's something, you know, people bury stuff down there. But it's common.
How does the news work there?
Well, if you report anything, there's a lot of reporters get killed and abducted in Mexico. So there's fear, right? But you would think, you know, there's a lot of fake news down there as well.
Mm-hmm.
But then you move up here and you're like, wow, this weird fake news is happening up here too. Like really, really fake news is happening up here too. Or twisted information is happening up here.
Yeah, we just take certain stories and spin them one way or the other, sort of depending on whose side we're on.
Case in point, El Chapo.
Mm-hmm.
All over your media, when El Chapo was extradited, when El Chapo was caught, he was the head of the Sinaloa cartel. This is the bad guy. This is the guy. This is the Osama, Mexican Osama bin Laden. This is the guy we've been after for all these years. El Chapo is probably number two, number three in the Sinaloa cartel, and always has been. He's not the head of the Sinaloa cartel.
Who's the head?
Amayo Zambada, who's a old school cartel guy that came out of that generation from the 70s and 80s that were the first kind of guys that got into the drug trade. He lived in LA for a while. You know, he set up all the connections as far as distribution on this side. Long time guy.
Is he catchable if we wanted to?
He is a very discreet man. He's a very dangerous man. He is a man that has connections that go all the way back to the 80s. There's rumors that he's a CIA guy, asset. You know, there's all sorts of rumors around this individual. And there's rumors of basically the U.S. betting on that cartel. So we can't keep control of all these cartels, so we're just going to support this one. So if you keep us informed if somebody tries to put a nuke through the border or something, yeah, we'll keep you informed. That's kind of like the going theory that people down there have as far as how the U.S. has – he's basically remained kind of untouched or not on anybody's radar till recently when El Chapo – El Chapo's trial kind of brought his name up more and more to the surface, right?
What do you know about Fast and Furious?
I was shot at with some of those guns, so I know a little bit about that.
Pick the right guy to talk to.
Yeah. So
what were we trying to do with that? We're trying to bring the guns over and then sort of trace the guns?
I don't know about the U.S. side, but I will tell you what the perspective was on my side. A single cartel, the Sinaloa cartel, started having all these weird, specific guns all of a sudden in their hands. One of the guns that they started to have was the P90s and FN57s as pistols that have a very high-velocity round that goes through soft body armor, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a very specific kind of pistol.
We're looking at one now.
Yeah, those they're called cop killers in some places. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of, you know, depending on the round and the specific load in the round, that thing can go through body armor. I found two of those lying next to the car that was shot up. A former agent that I worked with got killed outside of his house with his wife and their daughter.
Why did he? His wife, his daughter. How old was his daughter?
His daughter was five at that moment. Didn't die. Lost her arm, and they killed the agent and the wife. He could have been on the take. He could have been doing whatever the reasoning was. He got killed with two of those guns. I've never seen them, not even in a movie. I don't know.
They're
what they
very
were.
Modern and different looking. So, and they literally just left the guns?
Yeah, drop them.
All right.
It's not you don't keep you don't keep them. I've heard once a cartel guy. High-level cartel guys say, a sicario, basically a murderer said, you know, weapons are like condoms. You fuck with them once and you throw them away.
So they don't want to be caught with them on them.
No.
So they dropped us. So you show up.
We show up. We see them. I thought those are interesting. Take pictures of them. They get put into...
Is this guy a friend of yours?
Yeah, he was somebody that I came up with. Yeah, he was a friend of mine. I went to birthday parties and stuff like that at his house.
So but you still don't know why he was executed?
Some of these things you don't know. Did he piss somebody off when he was working? Did he choke out the wrong guy during work?
And why did they kill the wife and the kid too?
There's no rules anymore down there. That's old school. You know,
is it sending a message?
It used to be no women, no children type thing, but that's gone.
Really?
You know, one of the cartel hit squads, they would call them the Anthrax. The nickname was the Anthrax Squad because they would kill everything, you know?
Right.
No indiscriminate.
Anthrax, right.
So these started showing up. Barrett 50 caliber rifles started showing up, like in the box with everything in the box. Like somebody walked into a store somewhere in Texas and these started showing up on the Mexican side. AR-15s with Punisher skulls on them and weird American accessories on them.
So it felt queer in a non-sexual way. It felt weird to you.
It felt...
Your job at that time, you're how old and what's your job?
I'm in mid-20s. I'm part of the boom groups, basically a combined operational group where police, military, and a federal judge going around places. And if we didn't have a warrant to go into a property or a judge's order, he would write it on the spot and we would go into places. So we were very actively working against criminal groups in the environment they were working in.
So it'd be as if I would work in some neighborhood and I'm used to seeing the same kind of old cars out front. And all of a sudden I start seeing some brand new Mercedes out front. Yeah, and it seems weird to me.
It wasn't uncommon to see an Uzi, an AR-15, just, you know, AK-47, you know. And then all of a sudden we start seeing these weird, you know, space pistols and 50 cal Barretts being shot at with 50 cals.
Right.
If you've ever been shot at with one of those Barretts, you can hear the air disturbance going over your head. They were shooting. We were trying to move around in armored vehicles to keep some of our directives, our bosses safe. So they would focus on shooting at us with those 50 cals to try to pierce the armor mm-hmm. on these vehicles. So you saw up. So basically the arms race was
right.
Just was raised all of a sudden on us. And you know,
You're noticing something's going on, but you're not sure where those guns are coming from.
Yeah, we were. I was way below my, you know, pay grade. I was like, I didn't know what was going on. Learned about it after the. I learned about it from those hearings on CNN. You know, and
so we were going to give it to the Sinaloa cartel and then try to track them.
What I know is that that operation was during the. Almost at the tail end of the George Bush, the Bush administration, going into the Obama administration. It was something that was actively done. You were letting guns being bought in straw purchases by gun runners walk across the border and being sold to cartel guys to track where they would go. That, which makes absolutely no sense to me in any way, shape, or form.
And when they say track, and I don't know everything about the Fast and Furious, I know not a whole lot came of it, and I think Eric Holder was the Attorney General at the time, and I think the
first time that Obama invoked his privilege was because of the Fast and Furious, so he kept those things sealed as far as that. And
right.
It was related to that whole Fast and the Furious. So that's very telling on as an outsider.
Right.
And, you know, I still to this day thinking, you know, he knew about these things happening. It became a scandal when one of those guns was used to kill a U.S. law enforcement agent in Mexico.
Right. How could it go any other way? But did they literally put little tracking devices in the guns?
The going thing is that some of the bullets had tracking devices, that some of the guns had tracking devices, GPS type tracking devices, but no arrests were made that I know of that have been made public because of those traffic guns. No high-level cartels guys were put in jail. No international gun trafficker kingpin was arrested. All that happened on my side was we kept finding them around murder scenes and people being shot at with 50 cals in their vehicles and just seeing the carnage some of those rounds do to people. And we would just kept finding them. We would kept finding them, put them in the system, and all of a sudden they would be flagged. These guns are of interest to the U.S. government for some reason, so let's, you know, send them off that way. And we kept finding them, and they're still finding them. You know, they're still finding them out there.
I'd love to get to the fucking bottom of that one of these days. But so cartels, U.S., and China and Mexico. China's back on everyone's radar now. We talked a little about China running labs. Now we're back to sort of Wuhan. But, I mean, Mexico doesn't have the experience running those kind of high-level labs that the Chinese do.
They do,
or setting them up.
There have been fentanyl labs found in Mexico, and all of them have basically copy-paste elements to them. So you could see Chinese, basically, information advisors coming in and basically setting them up for them. Last time I was on here, I talked a little bit about it, And I got a lot of, yeah, no, it's not the Chinese government. It's the triads. It's the criminal Chinese. Those people saying that, been watching too many Big Trouble in Little China movies. There's no criminal underworld in China. China is in control of everything from top to bottom. Even the shady stuff that happens in China, Chinese state has a hand in it. Telling thing that happened recently. Fentanyl production and fentanyl, you know, getting into Mexico stopped because of the Chinese shutdown, right?
Right.
So cartels were starved for that.
Interesting.
So prices raised. So the first people that opened up the ports of entry for Chinese trade was the U.S. So you had fentanyl being somehow smuggled into the U.S. and then smuggled into Mexico that was caught when this was happening.
So you're smuggling fentanyl into Mexico.
From a U.S.
From the
port,
U.S.
Because the ports are closed down there, so there's nothing coming from China into Mexico.
Is it because Mexico needs to process it?
It needs to infuse its heroin with it.
Mm-hmm. So it had to go over there, and we caught it.
Yeah, so no, the Mexican officials caught this car with a bunch of fentanyl in it. A lot of it. I mean, a lot of it. So that shows you a few things. Production stops and starts because of the epidemic in China.
Mm-hmm.
So it stops and starts because the government says so. So they opened back up so fentanyl can go out again. The government said it. It wasn't like a criminal group's like, yeah, the government said it's okay now, so we can ship things out now.
Right. So what you're kind of saying is
there's an official government sanctioned something happens out there in China where they say, yeah, send some fentanyl over. Just keep this going. Keep this long war of drug attrition against the Americans that they don't even know they're in going.
Yeah, so in Mexico, the cartels aren't in charge of the government, but the government isn't in charge of the cartels either, and they're going to have to sneak over the border or tunnel or do whatever they're going to do, put it welded into gas tanks or whatever it is. But in China, that's not the relationship. The government is in charge. And if they shut it off or they say no, it's as if Mexico had the power to say, we're shutting the border, no more fentanyl going over to the United States. They couldn't do that.
You see this, the Hong Kong protesters were targeted by these so-called triads in the environment where they were, the gangsters were targeting the Hong Kong protesters because they're proxies for the Chinese government. You know, the government went at them full on from the bottom up.
Right.
So this whole concept of illegal precursors and fentanyl being smuggled from China into Mexico, and there's no shady criminal group that's independent from the government in China doing it.
Right.
It's Chinese state doing it. It has to be.
And we're so fucking gullible and stupid that all we have to do is have the president blame China, and then all our news agencies defend China, or all we have to do is have, you know, the Houston Rockets. Was it the Houston Rockets or San Antonio Spurs guy, like the GM, say stands with Hong Kong, and all of LeBron James and Steve Kerr and all those guys got to fucking school him up. It's so insane how fucking malleable these people are. That's the crazy part.
I mean, to me, by having that experience down there, now being up here, seeing the whole problem, you are in a war with China that has been going on.
Sorry, the Rockets. Yeah, Daryl Morey. Sorry, the Rockets.
China's in a war with you that's been going on for a long time. Economic warfare. You know, there's no more standing army against standing army. You're not going to exchange nukes, but they're going to degrade you from afar for a long time in some way, shape, or form, economically, socially.
I'm wondering if there's this new sort of chaos factor, which is this. So as long as you keep the fentanyl going here and everyone's strung out and fucked up and we're battling these endless wars, they can be freed up to knock off Big Bertha golf clubs and Schwinn bikes and do whatever they can be free to do whatever they want to do. And here's the thing that's interesting about this country and how fucking dumb our news media is. At a certain point early on, we had found out that the Russians and the Russians hacking of the election and this and that was not about pro-Hillary or pro-Trump. It was mainly stuff about Black Lives Matters and this group going against that group to cause division, to cause chaos. I mean, you could imagine it'd be so easy to win a war if the people you're fighting were fighting each other, right? And spending all their energy doing it. And it was about two years ago where the news outlets went, you know, it turns out there was only a couple of ones that were pro-Hillary or anti-Trump or whatever, but most of the stuff the Russians did was to try to get us to infight about cultural things, race things, things of that nature. We knew it. We found it out. We reported it. And then we went right back to fighting about the shit they were trying to get us to fight about.
Yeah. I mean, you have a big stick. You have you spend more on your military than any other country by far. And they're not going to fight a war with you one-on-one like that. They're going to find ways of doing it, you know, economically, asymmetrically, culturally, a war of ideas through, you know, I think part of that war is the current epidemic of fentanyl and meth precursors and things that going into Mexico. And that's just part of the whole new front line that they're opening up against the United States. That's my opinion as far as how I see it. And you can see people are making money. The first things that were started to be smuggled back into Mexico after the whole shutdown wasn't the precursors to make meth. It wasn't, they gave a priority to the fentanyl. That's right. The priority. So that there's a clear interest for that thing to keep going, you know?
Well, we're plumb out of time, but I feel like you can just come back every couple of months and we can just sort of pick up where we left off, because it's kind of macabre, but it's fascinating at the same time. And I just wish there was some light at the end of the tunnel here, but it doesn't sound that way. Who do they want? Last question. Who would Mexico like? Would they like Trump or Biden?
They like Trump. Most Mexicans are conservative. Most Mexicans get a kick out of, you know, the whole...
Who would the Mexican government like to see?
Trump.
Who would the cartels like to see?
Not Trump.
Huh. But the government, although they're pretty progressive and left-leaning, would like to see Trump.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because they're already established this relationship coming off the migrant caravan thing. And how basically Mexico said, "Yeah, we'll build a big wall on our southern border." Mexico did that, you know. All this talk about anti-wall building from the Mexicans in the U.S. and Mexico is building a big wall on their.
Oh, they're building a big wall on their southern border to block Central America.
Yeah.
Wow.
So there's a clear interest to keep that going on both sides.
Well, Ed's manifesto. .com is where you go. Twitter and Instagram, by the way, Ed's manifesto as well, Ed Calderon. Me, live events coming up, Nashville, June 12th and 13th. And just go to adamcarolla.com for all your information. Until next time, it's Adam Carolla. For Jimmy and Cousin Sal and Ed Calderon saying, mahalo.